So what did we say about that? Yeah, and what did we say about it, Beth? Yeah. Look at my notes. He called Abraham. Okay. Yeah. Oh, good. All right. So that's one part we remember. God called Abraham and said, come into this land. So there was a calling. And then when Isaac had a situation where there was famine in the land, God said, stay put. And then when Jacob had his situation, and the Lord said, wherever you go, I'll be with you. So it just spoke to me of a growth, of a maturity. But God calls us into a relationship with the Lord Jesus. He expects you to be settled and established and put down roots and grow. And then can we get to the place where we're that mature that the Lord will say to us, wherever you go, I'll go with you. Instead of me having to say, Lord, where are you going? But the Lord can bring me to a place where he says, you'll go with me wherever I go. That's quite a thought. It is, eh? Then the other thing we said is that God calls himself I am, which is kind of spiritual, if you like, because, you know, how do you relate to I am? But then he also brings it down to earth. And he says, I'm the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. I'm a God of people. I'm not just a God of the universe. I am, but I'm interested in people. I want my name to be associated with people. And he chooses Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And then there are lots of significances about that. Why did he choose them? Why didn't he choose some other three people's names? So there's an experience for us to see out of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And it's three people. It's not two. It's not four. It's three. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. So all those things are there. All right. Genesis 12. Better? Not much. So does that speak of Christ and the church? Which is the bride. There's lots of activities going on with the bride. Yeah. And there's lots of nyaga nyaga. And difficult. Yeah. Oh, very good. So we need to be that woman who gets things right. Amen. Okay, so chapter 12, verse 1. Now, the Lord had said. If the Afrikaans Bible, you see? Shall we go and have a look at the Afrikaans? I just want to see if it's also got that tense in there. Yeah. The Afrikaans nie so tense nie. Nee, man, maar dit is nog nooit verlede. Here het aan Abraham gesê. So it's something that had happened previously, and we don't exactly know when. Except that Stephen tells us about when God called Abraham when he was still in Mesopotamia. Remember that? Acts chapter 7. So often you read the Old Testament and then you read the New Testament and it sheds some light on it. Okay, so the Lord had said unto Abraham. What had the Lord said unto Abraham? Get thee out. So there's a calling for you to come out. Right? And then what happens? Ask me King James. Well, were there really any people at that time who were not sinful? Yeah. So the indication is that the world had once again slid into its normal state. So in the beginning, when God left them to do their own thing, they ended up, there was violence only continuously. And God had to bring it to an end. And then now from Noah, just after the flood, and then nyaga nyaga that goes immediately after the flood, that God has to again deal with them. So, you know, man just deteriorates. So I can't believe that it hadn't happened between Noah and Abraham. Things had again deteriorated. And so, yeah, Abraham lived amongst the people that were worshiping idols and doing their thing and so on. There's even an indication in the scriptures about your fathers on the other side of the river served idols. I can't remember where exactly that reference is, but it speaks about it when they come out of Egypt. Your fathers on the other side of the river. Indicating that Abraham and his ancestors were serving idols. But God called Abraham. So the Lord had said unto Abraham, get thee out of thy country, from thy kindred, from thy father's house, and unto. And that's what I actually want to talk about tonight. Get out, and to use the language there, get unto. Can I say in normal English, into? Yeah, you did. You should have done that. Yep. But just tonight, the emphasis, God calls us out and then into. So he doesn't just call you out and then leaves you. There's also into. What's between the out and the into? Just there's a gap, okay? What happens in the gap? Verse 2. I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. Or bless them that bless thee, and curse them that curseth thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. So what does Abram do? He leaves. He brought it, as the Lord had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him. I wonder which way around this worked. I wonder if Lot came along and said, please take me with you. Or I wonder if Abraham went along and said, good grief, I don't know what I'm going into. Lot, will you please come with me? Not too sure which way around it was. So it just says Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. And Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their substance that they'd gathered, and the souls that they'd gotten in Haran, and they went forth to go into the land of Canaan. Next little bit. Wasn't there a little bit after the land of Canaan? They arrived. So they went forth to go to the land of Canaan, and into the land of Canaan they came. Nothing about the journey. But in between the out and the into, there is a journey. Well, not necessarily, but there's a journey. There's something between coming in or coming out and going in. Okay? So here about Abraham, it tells us very little about that journey. Just so they left and they came in. Okay? But now, when we go and read about the children of Israel, what happens there? So there's a lot we can read, and I just want us to go to Exodus chapter 16. The Lord told him. The Lord said, come out from your people. Where's our stuff stuck? In the covenant. Maybe. Or Lot felt lonely. Or we don't quite know what the reason was for them going along, but it happened. And the Lord had said, let. It actually was. The Lord had told him not to bring, he told him to leave the family behind. Now, I'm going to try and copy a map here. And sorry, I'm not good at this. Get Carol to come and try and draw a map for me. But if we look at sort of where Egypt and Israel is, it's sort of something like this. I'm just going to draw this little bit here. Something like that. So we just cut off there. If over here is Egypt. Egypt goes across to there. To Sinai. So this whole area here belongs to Egypt. Today, over here somewhere, there's a place called Sharm el-Sheikh. Probably most people have heard of Sharm el-Sheikh. There was a bomb scare there not so long ago. So now, the thought is, where did the children of Israel cross the Red Sea? Because all of this here is Red Sea. So the thought is, that's a question. So they journeyed from here, and the thought is that they actually journeyed down to there. And that's where Pharaoh's army pursued them. And that they crossed the Red Sea there. And that they journeyed around here, and that Mount Sinai is there in Arabia. Whereas today, people will tell you Mount Sinai is over here. And they've built a monastery there. So The indication is that Mount Sinai is actually over there, because that is Arabia. Israel is up here. So Jerusalem is there. I don't know how to draw. Is it the Dead Sea or the Dead Sea? And is the Sea of Galilee a little bit smaller? Is the Sea of Galilee over there? Has the River Jordan between? There's the Sea of Galilee. Here's the River Jordan. So the idea is that they journeyed around here and eventually into there. So God had to take them here, because what did he say to Moses when he called him? When he told Moses, you go and fetch the children of Israel, I'm going to give you a sign. The sign will be that you will in this mountain come and worship me. So the mountain where Moses was, whether it was here, whether it was there, that's where they had to go back to. So to say this journey could have taken them something like 15 days is probably true, but is not fair, because God told them he's going to take them back here. Yeah. And he wouldn't take them that way because of what was going on there amongst the nations. He deliberately brought them a different way, number one, so that he could teach them. And then we read now here in Exodus chapter 16, this is what we read. There's Egypt, there's Egypt. That's also Egypt, actually, because the border of Egypt is around here somewhere. So whether they went, and so the thought is that they didn't cross here, so they crossed there. Or maybe up here, but the most likely spot is there. So what happens in chapter 16? Yeah, but he deliberately said he's not taking them that way because of what was going on amongst the nations there. He brought them this way. I think there was war going on. They said he wouldn't take them that way. Brought them this way. But also he told Moses he'll come back to the mountain. Chapter 16, verse 1. They took their journey from Elim, and all the congregation of Israel came unto the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on what day? Of what? The second month from where? Okay. Well, month and a half, isn't it, more or less? If a month has about 13 days. So wherever they were, if Elim is around here somewhere, that journey took them 1.5 months. So it wouldn't be unfair to assume that the rest of the journey would take another 1.5 months. And I'm estimating. So in 3 months' time, they could have gotten to Israel. So to say they could have gotten there in 10 or 15 days, well, yes, it's true, but it's kind of unfair, because God had to give them things. He wanted to bring them to the mountain. He wanted to give them the law. He had lots of things that he had to deal with them. And he deliberately brought them this way because there was war there and so on and so on. So I think it's fair for us to say that more or less 3 months, they could have gotten to the border. Could have gotten to the land of Israel. And I don't know how long it was before they got there and sent out the spies. Maybe someone knows if there was a date given. But here we're told it was on the 15th day of the second month that they got to this place, and the whole congregation of Israel did something. They complained. That's a modern word, eh? Because we don't talk about murmur anymore. And that's what my old English Bible says. They murmur. Yeah, grumble. That sounds good too. Grumble, mumble, complain. Okay? So they murmured. And they murmured against Moses and Aaron. Isn't it so true that so often the gripe and the moan comes against the servants of God? Because I don't dare, murmur against God. But men, I'll take on his servants any day. And so they murmur against Moses and they murmur against Aaron. Never mind Moses and Aaron are obeying what the Lord told them to do. And the children of Israel said unto them, would to God we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt. Send on the plagues, if you like. All the cattle died and there was the hail and the this and that. We'd rather have died in the plagues. And also the firstborn, remember? Would to God we had died in the land of Egypt. When we sat by the flesh pots. Now, I wonder how much food they had as a bunch of slaves. Eh? But, the memory does funny things to you. Not so. When you're in a difficult time, it's the worst. And you remember the good things that you had, and you don't remember the oppression you were under. You remember that your belly was full. I mean, they couldn't have had good food as if they were slaves. But we sat by the flesh pots. And when we did eat bread to the full, you weren't hungry. You have brought us forth into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. And so, you know, that's their situation. So what's their journey like? So there's the out, there's the in, and here's the journey. And without spending too much time on it, what happens in the journey? Lots of stuff. How many people make it to the end? Only two of the original. Only two. The rest, the way the Bible puts it, is quite strong. It says their carcasses fell in the wilderness. That's quite a tough way of saying it, isn't it? So Abraham's journey appears to have been a relatively short journey. Wherever it was he went from to where he came into, it just says he came out and he came in. This journey was quite a long journey. But it, because they got there, and then because of the bad report of the spies, they had to come back and they had to learn. So their journey took them 40 years because of disobedience and because of the way. So Paul tells us about it. Let's go and have a look at what Paul says. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Now, sorry, I'm not getting my head chopped off. Context isn't everything, but sometimes context gives us some indication of what's going on. Remember on Tuesday we spoke about the parable? Who was Jesus talking to when he told the parables? He was speaking to the Jews. And you know what we say about the parables? Why did Jesus talk in parables? So that they'd understand. He took common, everyday examples so that they would understand. And so that we would understand. You know what the Bible actually says? He spoke in parables so that they would not understand. That's actually what the Bible says. I'm pretty sure it meant the Jewish nation. Because they were of such a... So they would say, what's he talking about? What does he mean? And that's what they did, didn't they? They said, what does he mean? The disciples said, what do you mean? Give us the interpretation. Tell us what you mean by what you've said. And we today have the benefit of the interpretation. So we say, oh, well, yeah, it's easy, man. You just had to think this way and then you could understand it. But those who are standing, you go, huh? I'll destroy this temple and in a few days I'll raise it up. See, they didn't get it. We've got hindsight today. So we say, what's the matter? What's wrong with them? Why didn't they get it? But I'm telling you, if you were there, you wouldn't have got it either. Absolutely. We would have got it. So what does Paul tell us now in chapter 10? And who's he writing to? And what sort of people are the Corinthians? Are they very naughty? Okay. That wasn't quite the answer I was thinking of, but all right. So where is Corinth? In the temple. And where is all that, Stevie? In Greece. Thank you. Okay. So, okay, these guys are just Greeks. And I'm going to talk to the Greek who's opened the shop on the corner and tell him, you Oaks think he's immoral and naughty and everything else. All right? Not all Greeks are like that. So, but what it is, he's talking to the Gentiles. He's talking to non-Jews, but what's the second word there? Brethren. He's not talking to unsaved people. He's not talking to churchgoers. He's not talking to people who don't know Jesus. He says, brethren. Brethren, what don't I want? I don't want you to be ignorant. I can't remember, I don't know how many times Paul says that. I mean, he says both. He says, I don't want you to be ignorant. He says, I want you to know. He's forever saying, I want you to know, and I don't want you to be ignorant. And so that's why we search the scriptures to see whether these things we say. So he's talking to brethren, and he says, brethren, I don't want you to be ignorant about something. How that? All our fathers. So he's including the Jews as forefathers when he's talking to the Greeks. Because that when you become born again, you become part of the family of God. You in fact become a son of Abraham. That's what the scripture says. Why? Because God gave the promise to Abraham right in the beginning. And you and I become inheritors of the promise that God made to Abraham because we're the seed of Abraham. All right? So we become a father. Okay, so it says, all our fathers were under the cloud. And? They all passed through the sea. And? They were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. And? They all ate the same spiritual meat. And they? All drink the same spiritual drink because they followed them and that rock was Christ. So, can I be a little bit harsh? We're all sitting under the sound of the Word of God. We all have the benefit in the day and age in which we live of having printed Bible. We've got electronic ones too. We can read them at home, we can read them on the bus, we can read them wherever we are. We've all had these kinds of experiences. They're very similar to the nation of Israel, but there was a problem with some amongst them, wasn't there? The Bible talks about a mixed multitude. The mixed multitude went a-lusting. If we mix the world into our lives, be careful, we might end up lusting, diluting things, being distracted. So they all. But verse 5, what does he say? But with many of them, God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. So, in the book of Romans, we're told that we're crucified with Christ, we're buried with him, and we're resurrected with him. Out of death, out of sin, into life. And now? Okay, but now he has a journey. Until when? Till the day you die, or till the Lord comes to fetch us? What can happen on that journey? Yeah, lots of things can happen on that journey. But there are some people who say that God has predetermined that you will be saved, and no matter what, you will be saved, and if God determines you're not going to be saved, you will not be saved. What's Paul telling us? Paul's telling us they all came out, they were all baptized, they all had the benefit, but there were some of them that were disobedient and fell in the wilderness. So as much as God takes me out, brings me into this wonderful experience of resurrection, death, burial, and resurrection, gives me a spiritual baptism into Christ, asks me to be baptized in water, asks me to be baptized in the Holy Ghost, tells me I'm going to experience a baptism of suffering, baptized in the cloud and in the sea, and I'm just using terminology, just to give us this idea. Now there's a journey, and that journey needs to come to a conclusion or come to an end. And according to what Paul's telling us, verse 6, why were these things written? For our examples. This is to the intent that we should not lust after evil things as they did. So is it possible for someone to come to Jesus Christ, have their sins forgiven, be joined together with him in his death, in his burial, and in his resurrection, be filled with the Holy Ghost, walk in this newness of life, and yet get ensnared? Maybe not have a bondage, just get caught up. What was the problem with who was the guy that the earth opened up and swallowed him? Korah, in the valley of Achor. What was his problem? In what way? Did he go and steal the stuff from the pipe? Was he like, who is the guy that came and hid the stuff in his tent? Achan. Did Korah do what Achan did? What did Korah do? In the sense of being disobedient, or in the sense of? He wanted the position. He wanted the position. He said, aren't all the Lord's people equal? And what's the answer to that? Well, no, but yes. You know, we're all children of God. We're all sons of God. But God has given, in the New Testament, gift ministry. And he's given us different ministry. We don't all have the same ministry. And so there's a recognition of ministries, not a recognition of people. So there's a recognition of what God had called Moses to do, but Moses was the most humble man above all men on the face of the earth. So because Moses had this responsibility, he didn't become lifted up in pride because of it. It was Korah who now wanted to be lifted up, and he wanted to have the position. And so God says, no, that's not the way it works. Bring your rods. Every tribe, bring your rods and put them down in front of the tabernacle, in front of the ark, and go out and come back tomorrow. Dead sticks. I mean, when you go walking with a stick, what sort of a stick do you pick? You don't pick a green stick, do you? What are you laughing at? Yeah. A stick is dead, eh? So what would you call it if it's not dead? A branch? Yeah. Well, you don't pick a branch off a tree. You pick up a dead stick that's hard and solid and dead. That's what you use as a rod. It's not a lot. And it's those dead sticks they put before the ark. And they come back tomorrow morning, and Aaron's rod has budded and has got fruit on it. And God says, that's my choice. In this case, not my leader, because he was the priest. Moses was still being the leader. But Aaron was the high priest. And his house had to fulfill the priesthood, and not the others. It was available to them in the beginning. Because when God called Moses up the mountain, there was no selection between the Levites and the rest of the family. Everybody was called upon to become priests of God. They could all have been a part of it. But what did they do? I'm not sure whether they maybe did or didn't, but they certainly came right afterwards. Because when Moses came down from the mountain and said, this is a terrible thing that's happened, who's on the Lord's side? The Levites came to him. So whether they had been part of the building of the calf or not, I can't say absolutely for sure whether yay or nay. It's one of those things we don't really know. It's one of those things we assume. But they certainly then said, wow, and came out. Because Aaron, being the father of the Levites, he actually made the calf. Yeah. So I can't believe that the Levites didn't join him in doing it. But when it came to now say, look, this is wrong, come out now, who's on the Lord's side? All the Levites came. And because of that, they were rewarded with the priesthood. Okay. So it all happens. So but what should we not do? Well, it says we should not lust after evil things as they did. Verse 7. Now, why does he say that to people who are born again? Yeah. And you've been born? Yeah, these people are born again. These are New Testament Greeks. He says, they did it. Be careful. Neither be ye idolaters. As with some of them, we just find different idols. I wasn't going to be so explicit, Stevie, but there you go. Give me another one so that I don't say it. Eh? Chocolates, my dog. Sorry, no, not allowed to say that. My animals, my job, my position, my car. Motorbike, sorry. If only I had that Ferrari. My hobbies, yeah, sorry. Things can become idols in our lives, not so. So, Lord, be careful. Yeah. and it's all the Barbie dolls, and the models have to be skinny. I'm so pleased that the two big modeling agencies have now actually said that they'll keep a track on the weights of the models, and if they're below a certain weight or below a certain, what is it, BMI? Is that what it is? Body mass index? Then they'll actually not use them. But they still carry on anyway. Yeah, it's true. So, because, you know, things like that happen. The people sat down to eat and drink, they rise up to play. Isn't that happening today? People sit down, eat and drink, rise up to play. Don't let us commit fornication, as some of them committed, and fell in one day 320,000. Fornication really is just sex outside of marriage, premarital, whatever. It covers a multitude of stuff. It's not just adultery, it's fornication as well. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them tempted, and were destroyed of servants. Neither murmur ye. Now, who hasn't murmured? Some of them also murmured and were destroyed of the destroyed. All these things happen to them for example. And they are written for our admonition upon whom the ends of the world are come. Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth be careful, lest he fall. So is it possible for someone who's born again, baptized, full of the Holy Ghost, to fall away? Yes. Now, does that mean we've all got to be so afraid that we're going to fall? That's possible. So what we're saying is this. If I'm in the hand of Jesus, what does Jesus say? Not only that, he says, no man can pluck you out of my hand. But there's nothing that stops you from stepping out. Yeah. Yes, there is. Yes, but let me not trade on that either. Because if I fall away and Jesus comes, I'm gone. So, you know, why does Jesus tell us the parable about the 10 virgins? Yeah, okay, be ready. But there were 5 wise, and there were 5 foolish. Were they all 10 virgins? Were they all 10 waiting for the bridegroom? Were they all ready for the bridegroom? Until the bridegroom's coming was delayed. They were all ready. They heard the call. They weren't deaf. They went to the place where they were supposed to go and meet the bridegroom. Everything was exactly the same. The only difference, the wise virgins had extra oil. The only difference. There was no other difference between the two of them. Okay, you could say, well, there's a difference because they had foresight. That's why they had the extra oil. That's why, you know, yeah, okay, that's fine. But at the end of the day, they had the extra oil. They had foresight. They were prepared. They understood that there could be a difficulty. But we need to understand there could be difficulty, and we need to have sufficient to see us through the difficulty when it comes. Okay? Yeah. So the 5 went in, and the other 5, they stayed out. Never mind. So it's not scaremongering. We don't want to terrify people. We don't want you to be so scared, oh, no, I'm going to lose my salvation. No. You just hold on to Jesus, and you won't lose your salvation. But that's the thing. We need to hold on to the Lord Jesus. We need to think. Yeah. We need to take the directive. And as we travel through our wilderness experience, that we don't fall into this trap that these guys fell into. So we keep our eyes fixed on him, and we become part of the two. What is it? So if there were, how many spies were there? 12. So leave the 10, join the 2. Okay? 10 to 2. And let's make sure that we are of a spirit of Joshua and Caleb, and we're not of the spirit of the 10. And that's what we've got to look to the Lord for in our walk with the Lord Jesus. And as we do that, we will not fall. No, I don't think it's like that. I think it's just making sure that your cupboard is full. That's all. making sure that your cupboard is full, that there's, in a sense, there's oil on the rack. So that if opposition comes, then, you know, you're not, in other words, you're not saying, I'm depending. If this miracle doesn't happen, then finished and clear. If this miracle happens or if this miracle doesn't happen, whether I get thrown into the fire by Nebuchadnezzar or whether I don't, my God is able. And if he delivers me, thank you, Lord. If he doesn't deliver me, thank you, Lord, anyway. And that's the preparation of our hearts. So whatever comes, we're serving the Lord. We're not serving the Lord because of what he does. We're serving the Lord because of who he is. So this understanding of this journey. And Lord, I want to be prepared for the journey. And so Peter says something similar. Goodness me, look at the time. So let's quickly go to 2 Peter. Amper Revelation, but not. Peter and John and Jude and Revelation. So the second book of Peter. What does he tell us? Verse 1. Second Peter chapter 1, verse 1. He tells us who he is. And who's he writing to? So is he writing to born again? Okay. Grace and peace be. How? All right, mine says multiply. Yours says abundance. How? Through the knowledge. How are my people destroyed? Through lack of knowledge. Okay, so it's very important to know. It's like we've got to be so careful we don't know up here. It's got to travel from up here to down here. I've got to ask the Spirit of God to take the things of God and to write them in here. And I'm not just quoting the Bible. Because I'm telling you now, there are lots of preachers standing up every Sunday preaching and they know the Bible. But they don't know Jesus. And absolutely. And it's flowing. It's not engineered. In other words, the fact that we're preaching the Word of God is not because we've got a job. We preach the Word of God because we have a passion. And because Jesus is alive, it's a different thing. And so, okay, he tells them, he says, be careful. Be multiplied unto you. Now, verse 3, what's God done? I love these verses. I can go over them again and again and again. His divine power. Now, you know, people have really, and I really believe it's the devil, you know that? He belittles the word divine. Because now everything's divine. You give a little child a dolly and, oh, it's divine. And you give someone a dress, oh, it's divine. And you give someone whatever, and it's divine. And it's just belittling the word divine. Divine is God. And we've made it something of everyday use anymore. Yeah, that's how it should be. It's godly. Because divine is divinity. And divinity is God. And people have just brought it down to men's level. And it's just a subtle little thing. And please now don't go to your children and say, don't ever you use the word divine because you're talking about God and it's wrong. Don't do that. But just guide them. Just be gentle. Just say, like, hey, you know what divine really means? It really means like God. So you really think this dress is like God? Oh, no. Okay. Let's see. Anyway, so his divine power has given unto us. Where are you, Stevie? Verse 3. His divine power is given unto us? All things. Verse 3. He's given unto us all things that pertain to life and all things that pertain to godliness. And how? Through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us. And? So that? Of the divine nature. Yeah, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. What was Abraham given? Promises. What have you been given? Promises. But you've been given exceedingly divine promises. What did God promise Abraham? A great nation? All right, well, the child and the nation. Without the child, there couldn't be a nation. And you'll bless him. Apply it so quickly. Land. Promise you land. So there's so much of it that's earthy. All of it, actually. Surely blessing, I will bless you. Okay, so that could indicate there's spiritual blessing as well. But, you know, so much of it is earthy. And so much of the Old Testament is earthy. How did you bring a sacrifice? Physical. Where did they put the blood? On the altar. You burnt the sacrifice. You had incense. Earthly, it's all of the earth. And so Jesus says to the woman at the well, when she says, you know what, our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and you Jews say that we have to worship in the temple, what does Jesus answer? Because you neither worship God in the mountain nor in the temple, you worship God in spirit and in truth. And you know what people want to do? They want to go and worship God in the mountain. They want to go and worship God in the temple. They want to go and make an earthly place and say, we've got to go there and we've got to go do this and make things earthy. And we've got to dance like David danced. And we've got to bring the sacrifices like they did. And we've got to do it the Old Testament way. And the Lord says, wait a bit, wait a bit. I've dealt with it. You're not in the Old Testament anymore. You're in the New Testament. You go and look at the shapes of churches. What do they normally look like? Steeples, yeah? Yeah. But especially when you go to England and those old places. Beautiful works of art, but if you look at them from above, 99% of the time they look like that. And this is where heads are. And all the top brass are over here, and the not so good guys are back there. And these people can't even see what's happening over there. Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, there was this, I don't know. It's just crazy. And it's so much fashioned on the old way. In some of the traditional churches, as it were, I mean, what does the priest wear? Well, robes, dresses, garbs, like the Old Testament. Different colors for different occasions, like the Old Testament. And so easily, we just get pulled into the rituals of the old way. So Lord, help us, help us, help us, help us, help us. Okay, so be careful. What do I want you to do? Just read it again, verse 4. We've been given exceeding great and precious promises. You know, the promises of God are yea and amen in Christ Jesus, aren't they? The promises that if you come to Jesus Christ, you'll be born again of the Spirit. The promise is that there's a relationship now whereby you're in Him. You've been declared righteous. It's a promise to you. Yes, there are sometimes conditions that need to be fulfilled, but enter into the promises. Embrace them. Be there to take hold of them. You know, so that something might happen. That you might become partakers of what? So what's God asking us to do? Attend services. Obey rules. No. He's actually saying, yeah, but you can be a partaker of my divine nature. How? Because I'm putting Jesus Christ in you. I'm putting the Holy Ghost in you. I'm putting my word in you. That's what this new covenant is all about, isn't it? So who am I married to? He's the bride, groom, I'm the bride. And I'm married to Jesus. I've been joined together with Him in one spirit. So His divine spirit is in me if I'm born again. And in you if you're born again. You become a partaker of that divine nature. Because a husband and wife, it says they two will become one flesh. He that is joined unto the Lord becomes one spirit. So you're a partaker of that divine nature. So it's not something that you have to learn in your head. You don't have to say, oh, what does the Bible say? What do I have to do? Oh, I must do this, I must do that, I must do the other. It's a gift, Stevie, but it's a union. It's a merging of natures. And can you believe it that this Almighty God who created the heavens and the earth, this living Word, is joined together with me in a marriage union in the Spirit, so that I might become a partaker of His divine nature. Now, if I'm a partaker of His divine nature, how am I acting? Can you see the difference? It's not, oh, I have to do this, I have to do that, I have to do that. It's this, the Spirit within me overflows and begins to push out my way and brings in God's way. Now, how many of us are there? See? But does that mean I'll never get there? No, it doesn't. Like in the Spirit, the reality of it has happened. I've been given exceeding great and precious promises to be partaker of His divine nature. I've escaped the corruption that is in the world through us. God's done it. The problem is, do I believe it? When God took the nation of Israel into the wilderness, did they believe that God could provide food? I wondered. Yeah. That's right. Millions. Yeah. Never wore out. That's right. Oh, Stevie, it seems like their faith faded as they walked. It should have. Exactly. It should have. So when they got to the promised land, they must have already said, wow, 600,000 footmen plus women and children, God provided food for us. Look at our shoes. Look at our clothes. There should be no problem in getting into the promised land. Instead, oh, there are giants there and we like grass. They didn't believe. What do? We don't believe. Yep. And what? Yeah. And what were we, Stevie? Yeah. We were slaves. We were slaves to sin. And we've got a slave mentality. That's what it eventually became. Yeah. Yeah. So what Paul's telling us, watch out, watch out, watch out. It's all got to do with being a partaker of His divine nature. It's all got to do with a relationship. It's all got to do with fostering that relationship, nurturing that relationship, feeding that relationship, and then letting it outwork. See? So no wonder Jesus said, unless you're born again, you're not seeking your God. Because unless you have that awakening in your spirit, that union with Him, it's not going to happen. This is the only way. That's it. That's it. It's taking hold of the promises, believing them, and saying that what Jesus has done is real. And Romans chapter 6, Romans chapter 7, Romans chapter 8 really nails it down for us. Don't you know, don't you know, don't you know? Accept, believe, know that Jesus Christ has done it. Our time's gone. But now, just read the next couple of verses and maybe we'll chat about it next week. So now, having had this incredible experience of being brought into this place where you've escaped the corruption that is in the world, you've been made a partaker of His divine nature, as if that's not enough, what does He now tell us to do? Giving all diligence, add to your faith. Now, can I just convey it to you like this? Get going in your journey. This is your journey. Don't stand still now. What's the journey? The journey is Add. There's another word that's been used. You've got more modern translation? Verse 5. Now that's still add to your faith. There's another one. It's something about accumulate. Let me go and just look at another verse. It's just another way to put it. It's a nice way of putting it, I thought. Supplement. So there's like supplement your faith with virtue, supplement virtue with knowledge. So there's something now that there's a growth that God's expecting, isn't it? The way the old English puts it as an additional thing. Add. There's a growth. So what is God looking for? What must you add? Knowledge, temperance, patience, godliness, brotherly kindness, charity. Now, the word that they've interpreted as brotherly kindness is Philadelphia. You know that in Greek there are different words for love, eh? So the one is philo, and this one here is translated as brotherly love, which is Philadelphia. And that, and the last one, charity, is actually agape. Is that how you say it? Or agape? Agape? Agape love, which is God's love. Okay, and it's like sincere love for the brethren, because that's the end, isn't it? The brotherly kindness, charity. Now, verse 8. If these things be in you, and what happens? They make you, if you're neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of Jesus Christ, but he that lacks these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. So rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure, because you will never fall. If you do those things, you will never fall. But he's saying, if you're on that journey where you're looking to God to add to you the reality of what his nature is, you will never fall. But what am I about? What's important to me in this life? To look to the Lord that these things are being added in my life. To keep on the journey. To keep growing. To overcome. And you know, there's a lovely verse in the book of Revelation that says they overcame him how? By the word of their testimony and by the blood of the Lamb. So, Lord, by your grace, I'm holding on to the finished work of Jesus. I'm not saying, look at me, how I shine. And maybe you could think that when you read it. Add to your faith virtue. Ooh, I've added virtue to my faith. Add to virtue. Ooh, I've added things. No, that's not what it's about. It's about actually saying, I'm decreasing. And he is increasing. Lord, as we do that, we will never. And we don't need to be afraid about being left behind. We don't need to be afraid about falling away. We don't need to be afraid. But man, I've got my hand in Jesus. He's not going to let me go. All I've got to do is hold on to his hand. Oh, that's my warning sign. Okay, thumbs up. All right. So go and read that and meditate on that, and maybe next week we can talk a little more. Bless you. Amen. Thank you. Let's pray. Wow, Lord. Out of and into. And in between, there's a journey. Lord, help us, we pray, that our journey is not round and round and round in the wilderness. Help us, we pray, that our journey takes us to the places where you want us to. Lord, they had to be taken into the wilderness. They had to be given your word. They had to be shown the things that they had to be shown. There were things that they had to learn. They had to learn how they were going to behave in the land that they were going to. And so there was a time, and there was a journey that needed to happen. But Lord, help us that we don't let it. In the wilderness, says the Lord went before them in the form of a cloud, a three-day journey. And Jesus has gone before us, a three-day journey. Death, burial, resurrection. Help us, Lord, to enter into that. Help us realize that you've brought us to a place where we can be partakers of your divine nature. May we embrace that, Lord. May we look to you to grow in grace and in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus, day by day and moment by moment. thanksgiving. Amen. Thank you. Out of and into.